Welcome to our DMACC Career Discovery event. We are excited to have a couple of professionals from CRU, Commercial Real Estate Women, with us today for our Ask a Professional session. But before I introduce our professionals, I would like to say hello. My name is Jill Hoik, and I'm accompanied by my colleague, Amy Stainhook, and we are both a part of the work-based learning team at DMACC. So we thank you all for being here today. And now I would just like to say thank you to our professionals for being here today too, taking time out of your busy schedule to enlighten us about your careers and furthermore. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce them. We have Emma Diaz here with us today, and she is the Vice President of Locate Commercial Real Estate. And then we have Suri Fleeler, and she is a registered interior designer with Shive Hattery Architecture and Engineering. So again, thank you both for taking time out of your busy schedules to be with us today. I will kind of open it up with a first question. Emma, we'll start with you. Can you just kind of, you can introduce yourself a little bit more than what I did, but then also just kind of take us through how you got, kind of began your career and where you are today as a vice president.
Sure. Well, first off, thank you for having me. Let me know if there's any like audio issues or if you can't see me. Please feel free to interrupt. So I am a Des Moines local, went to Valley, then went to Iowa State. Obviously now I work in commercial real estate, but that took a very left turn from my primary education, which was in marketing, but then also apparel merchandise and design. So from there, I worked for a startup after college, and then the startup kind of went under, which is a risk I was willing to take. From there, I landed a marketing position at a commercial real estate firm, previously then NAI Optimum. Knew absolutely nothing about commercial real estate, was just qualified with my marketing background. I was very heavily design, graphic design oriented, which all of my apparel, merchandise, and design then came into play and kind of gave me those skills necessary. So they kind of took a shot on me, but I'm glad that they did. I ended up just really diving in full force and learning what commercial real estate even was. So from there, we were a smaller company, probably I think there was less than 50 of us total. We rebranded from NAI Optimum to a larger corporation called Cushman & Wakefield. So I was leading the marketing at that time, so was responsible for the entire rebrand to this global company. So with that came literally anything and everything you could think of. All of our flyers, signs, website, headshots, brochures, mugs in the kitchen, pens, I mean, just truly anything you could think of that goes along with the company I was responsible for, which gained a lot of experience. It was a lot of hard work, but something that really kind of, again, set me up for where I am today. While working in marketing at Cushman & Wakefield, I kind of worked very closely with all of the commercial real estate agents. My job was to help them produce any hard materials or deliverables for their clients. So really from that, I learned firsthand what a career in brokerage looks like and the work that it entails. And I decided I wanted more. I kind of saw that the sky was limitless in a career like that. Your success is fully based on how hard you are willing to work. And that was something that really enticed me. I didn't have to wait around for my next raise or promotion to be handed to me. It was something I could actively work towards on a daily basis to improve myself. So I ended up getting my commercial real estate license. I worked very closely with a smaller group of people in the office of four. And then shortly after that, we decided to branch off from Cushman & Wakefield, and we started our own company, Locate Commercial Real Estate, which is where I am now. So, you know, and working through all of the rebrand and doing all of that really kind of gave me firsthand experience of everything that needed to go into starting a new commercial real estate company, because that's essentially what it was. So I had kind of already done that once before, and then partnered with all of the brokerage experience of my team, you know, that just totals, you know, decades of experience. We were really kind of set up for success. So that happened simultaneously, actually, with COVID and lockdown. We moved into our new office on Monday, and the governor actually had shut everything down that same Friday. So it was quite simultaneous, but really allowed us to kind of get our feet under us, you know, get our phone number set up, our internet, like all the things. So we could really hit the ground running when everything kind of came back, and it did. So wow. Hopefully that answered the question. I feel like I really went on about that one, but.
No, that's great. It's always nice to hear, you know, professionals when they kind of talk about how they started and where they're at now. It's always very interesting to kind of hear the story. So thank you for that. And Suri, what about you?
Hello. Yeah, my name is Suri Fleeler. I'm an interior designer. So I also went to Valley, a couple of years difference from Emma, but grew up here locally. Went to Valley, and I took about every art class I could get my hands on. I mean, like anything that had to do with art, I was there. I was pretty convinced I was going to go to art school after high school, and then kind of started looking into the cost of art school, the job opportunities after you get out, and was convinced maybe there's another route for me. So I started exploring opportunities in building design. So when we talk about commercial real estate, we're talking about really any kind of project that is at a high level, not residential. So if you think of houses and what a home broker might do, Emma kind of does that, but for a commercial level. So kind of help give a basic of what commercial real estate is, very broad term that we use. So I'm a commercial interior designer. So I work on pretty much any project type that is not a house. That is an avenue within interior design. We just don't do residential here at Shive Hattery. So I went to a four-year school in South Dakota. I went to South Dakota State University. It's a four-year accredited interior design program, but there are different avenues. I know DMACC has an interior design program. That's a two-year program. And ultimately, the difference is after you get out of school, you need a different amount of work time in the profession before you can get your registration or your certification. So lots of different routes to get to a commercial interior design position. I think it's an awesome option for me to get to be creative. You know, interior design gives us outlets to work with people. I love working with people. I mean, if you sit me in front of a computer and make me just do computer stuff, it's not going to be my best day. Some days are good like that too, but I really like getting to work with the client, see how we can help them solve a problem through design and really give them something that makes them go, wow. Whatever that wow might be at the end of the day, that's like the most rewarding thing for me.
That's awesome. And then can one of you just talk a little bit more about Crew and how you guys all kind of engage together and what types of things you do?
Sure. So Crew is Commercial Real Estate Women. I believe we were founded about 5 or 7 years ago, our Des Moines chapter. It is nationwide, and it's really an opportunity to bring women and people from commercial real estate together and learn more, provide educational opportunities, provide networking opportunities, provide outreach opportunities like this, where we are able to give back and teach people about what commercial real estate is. That's kind of a high level in a nutshell. It's a professional organization, and we are committed to being the best real estate organization here in Des Moines.
Awesome. Thank you. Yes, Amy, thank you for putting that in the chat. you guys both kind of talked a little bit about your education and training required. But for people kind of in commercial real estate, we'll kind of talk about it maybe as a whole. What are kind of the different levels? Do you guys have people within your industry that don't have college education? And then does it go up to, you know, doctorate levels? Or can you kind of talk about the wide varieties? I know there's a ton of different entities within commercial real estate, and it probably depends on what you're in. But can you just talk about the wide variety of different education levels that you would need to have?
Sure. That is a very broad question, but I'll give you maybe my best overview. So from a, you know, no secondary education level, we've got tons and tons of needs in the construction side. None of what we can do can happen without that construction side. I mean, it doesn't become reality. And there are a ton of great apprentice programs through electricians, through welders, plumbers, those kind of entities. So that's kind of one of the routes without any post-secondary education. Within the design field, we have technicians, or like I said, even interior design can have a two-year route. So maybe you have just a post-secondary, a two-year associate degree. And then there's lots of four-year options. And then we also have, for sure, attorneys are a huge part of commercial real estate too. So then you've got more beyond your bachelor degree. I'm sure there's more doctorate and PhD positions I'm not even aware of. But that's kind of, I don't know if I totally answered that, but a little bit of a full breadth.
Yes.
Emma, do you want to expand upon what a route to be a commercial broker might look like?
Yeah, absolutely. So actually, to be a commercial real estate agent in Iowa, you do not technically have to have any college level education. Really what's required is you go through the classes to get your real estate license in Iowa. If you receive that license and work through that specific training and coursework, that applies to either residential real estate or commercial real estate. However, that's not necessarily a route that I would super recommend. You know, I would at least think that you would want some level of base, probably specifically in finance. Mine is in marketing, which is great. You know, obviously there are a million paths to get to where we are, but I think some foundational level past high school would be definitely helpful. The biggest thing about stepping into a brokerage role within commercial real estate is finding a mentor. This is I like to call it a lifelong learning process. Like, I learn new things every single day, and I wouldn't be able to be on quite the progression route that I am should I not be surrounded by people willing to invest and take the time to help and teach me. You know, the classes are great, but it's only 60 hours of coursework. And that is not enough. That does not explain kind of what this really looks like and what you need to know. You know, like we've kind of touched on, commercial real estate is such a broad spectrum. There are so many facets involved, so many different employment opportunities, all the pieces of the puzzle working together. And there's really just so much to learn and absorb that you kind of need someone or some sort of team or mentor helping you along the way. If you didn't have that, specifically in commercial real estate, I can't speak to residential as much, but specifically commercial, you do need help and guidance.
Yes, great advice. Either one of you can take this one. What do you feel like a part of your career so far is your biggest win, would you say, a part of your career? Emma, do you want to?
Sure. So I would say, you know, taking the step into brokerage, you know, I was previously in the commercial real estate industry, but taking the step into brokerage, you are full commission. I have no benefits. I have no guaranteed salary. I only make the money that I can close deals on. So taking that step to begin with was quite momentous, I would say. I don't know. I mean, it was a risk in and of itself, but I'm glad that I did. And then taking that a step further, us as a team leaving our former company and starting our own company, and just reaping the rewards that much more of everything that you work for truly sees itself back to you, is by far my biggest win. And I'm my own boss. That's fun too.
Absolutely.
To answer this one, do you mind if I maybe share one of my recent favorite projects that I've worked on?
Absolutely. Share my screen? Love that. Yes.
Be a little more visual.
Absolutely.
Okay. Give me 1 second. Hold on.
Yes.
Okay. So this actually happens to be, hold on 1 second, I want to get to the right slide. So one of our recent projects that we actually have done is for DMACC's Urban Campus. So the Urban Campus new student center will be opening sometime this year. And this was just one of the most fun projects that I've had recently that I got to work on. So this team would be huge that works on it in our world. I mean, we're talking about there's civil engineers, architects, designers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, lots of people. But I thought I'd just give a little highlight as to what interior design looks like in a project and kind of show you like what my love is or what how I consider this my biggest win. So just high level, we start with a very basic understanding of what a client's goals are. So this diagram is just showing like how many square feet when we're talking about, you know, real estate, we're talking about basically how much area do they need to start off with. And so this is an early diagram that helps show how people might move through the space, where certain areas might be. This project happens to be mostly creating like hangout zones for students, classrooms, and a science lab component. So this is the early diagrams. From a site perspective, Interiors is working with architects and landscape architects and civil engineers. So this is a site plan. Think of it like a bird's eye view, looking down at the campus and thinking about how is that new building, which is shown right here, gonna connect with the rest of the site. Then we start to get into space planning. And like, I truly love every part of design. It's so much fun for me. So space planning is like a big puzzle. How do you make all the parts and pieces fit inside your constraints? From an interiors perspective, we are really working within the exterior walls. We do not really go outside the exterior walls. If you're interested in that, architecture might be a better realm for you. So there were 3 floors. So just high level, we start with these kind of blocking diagrams for a space plan. Then we think about what is the client trying to achieve with this project? How do they want people to feel? And we start collecting inspiration images and mood boards and create these basically inspiration that's just specific to this project. So these kind of show a scattering of what the client might expect to see at the end of the project in their design. And then we get to move into visualization. So we use computer software to 3D model all of our designs, and then take them to that next level and really what we call render them. So this is, it looks like a photorealistic image, but they are done to help convey what's that final design gonna look like. So this happens to be the entrance as you're walking into the campus. This is kind of the first feel you get for the campus, and you got big glass walls looking out further into the campus. You got clear wayfinding to help direct people to different spaces within the building. And tie it all together in this central hub. There's a coffee shop, so that was kind of the first coffee shop I'd ever designed, so that was a fun challenge. And then they have this large hangout zone, really a neat, just thinking about how can this be multifunctional? How can it create space for students to come and just do their studying or do group work? It was something that the campus didn't have a lot of space for, and they really, really wanted to be able to provide that for students. I mentioned the science classrooms. So there was a heavy lab component, and all the intricacies that go into designing a lab space. For any of you who have been in a lab space, you can probably think about all the gases and the water and the hoods and all of the fun stuff that comes with that. So interior designers and planners get to think through all of those fun connections and then how to also make it look good. It's not all just about making things look good. So I highlight just high level, all of those visualizations I've shown have to get documented in a way to get built. So we have, I think this set had 210 total sheets, and each sheet is a 30 by 40 inch sheet, and it has information on the sheet to be able to tell a contractor how to build the design. So, I mean, just kind of from a nitty gritty perspective, this is the detailed level of information that has to get documented to show how it gets built. I throw out their ceiling plans, finish plans, every wall that has something unique on it gets elevated. So there's a ton of detail work. If you think that's something that you're interested in, you have to be very detailed to be an interior designer. And then just high level, here's what it looked like after the parking lots were gone. This was in September 2019. Here you start to see the foundations go in. Continuing structure keeps building up. This area is the big open space with that big stair and the coffee shop that I showed. Again, just start to kind of see it progress. I think, so if it started in September 2019, this is about a year later. And then we're starting to get finishes in, you know, about a year and a half after construction began. Here's the labs going in, entrance element. Project completion is coming soon. So I know I flew through that, but hopefully it gives you a little bit of an idea of what it means for me when I say I love interior design, or what all goes into it.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that. That is awesome. Amy wants to know if you designed the Waukee Apex Center in Waukee.
We did not. Nope.
Okay. I think that's really great that you kind of showed all the entities, right? Like sometimes when you think about interior design, you're like, oh, they just make it look pretty, but so much stuff. And also just the budget, you know, like the budget of the project and being able to stay within that. So thank you for sharing that. That was awesome.
Of course, yes.
So along that, Emma, what would you say are some personality traits for maybe a potential student like looking in to commercial real estate? What personality traits do you think that students looking in going into commercial real estate should have?
Yeah, and you know, there are so many different opportunities within commercial real estate. Kind of whatever your personality is, you could find a career to fit that. You know, if you're heavily like more analytical, very logical person, you know, I mean, we touched on it earlier, you could be an attorney, you could be a real estate attorney, you could be reading contracts, you could find yourself loving that. In terms of if you're a very creative person, you know, you can find yourself loving kind of more what Siri does within like the interior design work, or more of like a marketing or design background. For my role personally as a commercial real estate agent, I would say that it's very important to be very social. I would say this being an agent is not necessarily one for anyone who is shy. You really have to put yourself out there. You have to be very resilient. You get a lot of no's, you get turned down frequently. You get a lot of people telling you to kindly lose their number. So you have to kind of just have a tough skin a little bit. You have to be willing to put yourself out there. And most importantly, you really have to have a strong work ethic. This is not something, it's something that looks easy on the surface. And, you know, kind of when you see people out and about and all the networking and all the socialization aspect of it, it can look easier than what it actually is. There's a lot of time and effort that goes into it, and you truly can't be successful if you don't put in the time and the hours.
Yes, thank you for that. And Siri, probably for you too, people are like, oh, how fun, interior design, they just make things look pretty, but it kind of, there's a lot more that goes into it. But for, on an interior designer standpoint, what would you say are some of the key personality traits? You mentioned orient, like being detail oriented.
Very detail, yeah. Everything that we do comes down to the details. I mean, it really makes or breaks the space. People don't notice always like the green things, but they notice when something's wrong. So I do think a level of creativity, a level of self-motivation, but also wanting to work on a team. We are very team-based with what we do, because our projects are too big. You can't do it all yourself. Which honestly, going through school, like that wasn't me. I often did not like being on the project teams. I didn't like, I don't know. It wasn't really me, but in the real world, I love being on teams. So I think it comes down to who you work with. I think the people person, like Emma said, I'd echo that and being social, because ultimately everything we do for interiors comes down to people using space. And if you don't really interact with or relate to how somebody else is going to use space or put yourself in someone else's shoes, it's really hard to design a space for them. You're not designing for yourself. You're designing for your client. So I think that I'd echo that, but otherwise I thought Emma summed it up really well, but creativity, hard work, detailed.
Awesome. Yes. Thank you. And just I'll have two more questions just to be respectful of time. Emma, what would you say is one of the most toughest parts of your job, or maybe some challenges that you face every day?
Yeah. I would say the biggest thing that I've overcome is really learning how to work with the ebbs and flows. Deals, big or small, can come together very, very quickly, and they can also fall apart very, very quickly. So just being able to kind of ride the waves and be flexible and go with the flow and learn how to kind of evolve to constantly just keep yourself moving with momentum, and to not get discouraged if something blows up and you can't like hang on it forever. Like you really just kind of have to move forward and keep going. But at the same time, you can put a lot of work into something and it can come through, or you can put very little work into something and it can come through. So that would be, I think, the hardest thing is just learning how to work with the waves and ride them, and good and bad.
Yeah, I think that is great advice no matter what career you're in. So thank you. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. And Siri, what about you?
Yeah, I was thinking the exact same thing, Emma. You said that very well. I think the other thing for me, toughest part of your job. Lately, keeping up on communication, especially with everything being virtual and the pandemic this last year, oh my goodness, just keeping up. You don't think about it going into a career, but the number of emails you deal with that day, it's just so hard to keep it all straight. Communication is key to what we do. I think that is really making sure everyone has clear direction, the right communication, and the client has the right communication. It's just, that is sometimes tough.
Yeah, balancing communication with like your day-to-day tasks, right? Like, and sometimes when people are asking you for things and you're not there yet, it's like, oh my goodness, I will work on that right now. So yes, yep. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. All right, well, last question, just to kind of sum up this event with you two. For students looking into commercial real estate, or maybe on the brokerage side, or maybe more on the interior designer side, you can kind of take this question where you want to. What advice would you give young students looking into professions like this? Is there anything they could be doing now, studying now, volunteering, doing things? What advice would you give them? Emma, we'll start with you.
Sure. So I would say, first off, just getting yourself involved and chase whatever it is that you're interested in. You know, I was interested in my apparel merchandising and design, and I chased that. And having that background and that experience has helped lead me to where I am today. So chase what you're interested in, but be open to any and all new opportunities and just keep your eyes open. And also always be kind of on the forefront of how am what I'm doing now going to help me get to my next step? What is it interested in and where do I want to go? And then in terms of if you already know you're interested in commercial real estate, getting yourself involved and meeting as many people as you possibly can and learning about as many different careers in commercial real estate as you can to help find the right fit for you. Like I said, I have an apparel merchandise background and I'm in commercial real estate. My husband graduated with a degree in industrial engineering. And he also now works in commercial real estate. So really there's no truth path, just follow whatever it is that you're interested in and you can get there.
Yes, great advice. I think no matter where you're going, you can always take skills from whatever you are in into the next adventure, right? I think that that's kind of what you were saying is just go after what you want. And if it doesn't work out, that's okay, because you're still going to use a lot of skills into your next adventure. So,
right.
And Siri, what about you?
Yes, I would highly recommend thinking about what is it you're passionate about and how can you turn that passion into a career? Because if you do what you love, it sounds cliche, but it doesn't feel like work. I mean, if you can really do what you love, that's a really neat thing in life. I would say also take as many job shadowing opportunities as you can or internships. But if you're in high school right now and you have either, you know, if you're interested in anything we're talking about here, please reach out and we can connect you with someone in crew and someone in one of those industries that we've, any of them that we've talked about today. But if there's something else that maybe a friend's parents are connected to, like, take advantage of those kind of relationships, because even if you hate it after a job shadow day, that is time well spent. If you could figure out you hated it now, then go for more education for it and then find out you hate it, that's too bad. Find out now what you might be interested in and explore as much as you can. I mean, there are so many careers, like Emma and I have said, like, we didn't even know these were careers in high school. And so just the more you can get exposed, I think that is really, really neat and well worth your time.
Awesome. Well, thank you too so much for your time and expertise. I learned so much as well. So thank you again for kind of enlightening us on all the facets of commercial real estate. So thank you, Siri. Thank you, Emma, for being here today. And if there isn't any other questions, we will go ahead and conclude this Ask a Professional session. So thank you all for being here today. Thank you.